Okay, so I've just looked it up and reminded myself what happened. So the bomb accidentally goes off. The student revolutionaries are making a bomb and it accidentally goes off. This is in the city of Wuchang. And the local Manchu governor of Wuchang had the students arrested and executed for their revolutionary activities. Now, what happened next is quite extraordinary, because soldiers within the new army that the Qing had created under the leadership of Yuan Shikai, many of whom were sympathetic with the revolutionaries, because they too thought that the Qing had let China down in recent times, they then mutinied against the local governor, and they then they turned on local citizens, on local Manchu citizens, and they turned on the Manchu governor. And what happened in Wuchang as a result of this sort of botched attempt by student revolutionaries was that the army in Wuchang declared the independence of the province that Wuchang was in, which is Hebei province, declared independence from the Qing dynasty. And what happened was that this created sort of a ripple effect throughout the country, and news of this rebellion and news of this mutiny spread throughout the whole of China. And over the next few months, more and more cities and regions started declaring their independence from the Qing. And a key reason why this happened was because the regions had been kind of almost encouraged by the Qing to have a bit more independence because of the provincial assemblies that the Qing had set up in 1909. So you can see how the Qing, in a way, had kind of shot themselves in the foot. Now, Sun Yat-sen had not been in China while any of this was going on. He'd been in America, but by December he hurried back to China. He came back to China on the 16th of December, and on Christmas Day 1911 there was a conference of regional leaders from 16 different provinces around China, and they decided that Sun Yat-sen should be the president of a new Republic of China. They basically called time on the Qing dynasty. They said, "That's it. We are not an empire anymore. We're not having any of it. We want to be a republic, and we want Sun Yat-sen to be president of that republic." And that happened on Christmas Day, 1911. Now that's great, but the Qing are still there. They're still living in the Forbidden City. They haven't decided to formally abdicate or anything like that. And you know, they still hold the levers of power. The other powerful institution is the army that's led by General Yuan Shikai. Now he plays a really interesting role here in sort of between sort of Christmas 1911 and February 1912. He basically wants to get a good deal for himself, and he realizes that he's in a really strong position because he's the only one that really controls a sizable army, whereas Sun Yat-sen and the revolutionaries, the nationalists, don't do that. And he also realizes that Puyi and his dad, Prince Chun, are in a really weak position. So he says to Prince Chun, "Don't worry about the revolutionaries and their declaration of independence. I'll go and deal with them." He travels south. He meets Sun Yat-sen. He and Sun Yat-sen have a conference. Sun realizes that actually he doesn't have the power, the muscle, really, the military power to control China, and Yuan says to him, "Look, I'll do a deal with you. If you back me as President of the Republic, I'll go back to Beijing and I'll speak to Prince Chun and I'll get Puyi to abdicate, I'll get the end of the empire, and I'll be the provisional president of the new republic, but we'll have elections next year." Now this is the opposite to what Yuan had promised to Prince Chun. He said to Prince Chun, I'll go down there and deal with these rebellious revolutionaries. But Yuan plays a double game. Sun Yat-sen realizes that Yuan Shikai holds all the cards here, and Sun agrees to Yuan being the president of the Provisional Republic until their elections next year. Yuan then goes back to Beijing, says to Prince Chun and to Puyi, I can't do anything about it. I can't control them. They're too strong. They've got too much strength. You have to abdicate. And so in February 1912, Prince Chun signs the abdication. Yuan lets them stay in the Forbidden City, lets them continue living in luxury, but that's it. That's the end of the Chinese Empire. So, the question was, why does the empire collapse? Well, it's lots of reasons. It's to do with, you know, mistakes by student revolutionaries, it's to do with Yuan Shikai, it's to do with humiliation by foreigners, it's to do with the failures of the late Qing reforms, it's to do with Sun Yat-sen and the existence of an opposition, it's to do with all the humiliation caused by foreigners. What's the most important reason? You decide. That's up to you. But you're going to be asked the question, how far do you think it was to do with this one thing? And of course, it's never to do with one thing. It's always to do with the interplay of lots of different factors. And it's a complicated story, but it's an interesting story. And good luck writing your first essay.